So today we will discuss about some questions from chapter 3. And in last class we have already completed the syllabus, all the topics we discussed. So let us see the first question, that is, a 10 ohm resistance is connected in series with a cell of EMF 10 volt. Okay. A voltmeter is connected in parallel to a cell and it reads 9.9 volt. Find internal resistance of the cell. Okay. Now from the question, it is clear that a voltmeter is used here. Right? This one is a voltmeter. And it is given that the voltmeter, how much the voltmeter is measuring? The voltmeter is measuring 9.9 volt. So this is not the EMF of the cell, but it is the terminal potential difference. Okay, so if it is a terminal potential difference, that means it is the value of V, then the value of EMF is how much? 10 volt, and a 10 ohm resistance is connected like this. Alright, so this 10 ohm resistance, it is certainly, it is the external resistance, because internal resistance it remain inside the cell, and in this question you have to find out that internal resistance. Alright, now which formula we can use for to solve this sum? First of all, you have to write what are the things given. Okay, so that's what I have written here, and then for R you have to make a formula. So here you can see that I have used this formula, small r is equal to E minus V by V into R. E is the EMF, V is the internal it is the terminal potential difference, and capital R is the external resistance. Now the question is, from where did we get this formula? Okay, so if you remember, we applied this formula in many cases in this chapter. Alright, so from this formula only we can obtain this formula also. And how we can obtain it? Let us analyze this formula. Okay, so from this we can get this line, right? Just cross multiplication. Then in place of IR, I into capital R, which is the external resistance, we can write V. V equals to IR, Ohm's law. Okay, in Ohm's law we don't consider any internal resistance. We don't have the concept of internal resistance or EMF in Ohm's law. So in Ohm's law, whatever we have only external resistance. And the whatever potential we have, that is the terminal potential difference, no concept of EMF. So in place of IR, we can write V. Alright, now plus IR, this is equal to E. So from this, E minus V equals to IR. Now I will come down, so we get this this line we got. Then after that, in place of I, we can write V by R, because V equals to IR, so I equals to V by R, right? So if we write so, we can get this formula which we are directly applying here. So you don't have to do this much, just you have to remember this formula, that this formula, okay, that we are applying here. So now simple, now you just have to substitute the values given and we'll get 0.101 ohm. You can calculate it. I think this calculation is correct only, so it is 0.101 ohm. Alright, then next one. So in this question, one very important thing that you have to remember is that, if you remember, we discussed about the dependence of temperature and resistance of a conductor. So I told you that conductor and the resistance of a conductor and the temperature, they are directly proportional. So if they are directly proportional, by which relation we can relate them? All right. So for that we have a relation, this one. So let us analyze the terms involved in this equation. So first of all, let us see the question. The resistance of a nichrome wire is 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, resistance of a nichrome wire at 0 degrees Celsius is 10 ohm. Alright, now if its temperature coefficient of resistance is this much, find the resistance at boiling point of water. Okay, temperature coefficient, I'll tell you what is this. But first of all, let us analyze the formula that we used. RT is equal to R0 1 plus alpha T. So in the question it is given that we have taken nichrome wire and its resistance is 10 ohm at how much temperature? 0 degree, because we know that as the temperature changes, the resistance will change. So this 10 ohm resistance is only at 0 degree. but now the temperature is the boiling point of water. That means it is 100 degree Celsius. So the question is that at 100 degree how much will be the temperature? At 0 degree the at 0 degree the resistance is 10 ohm. At 100 degree how much will be the resistance? Okay, that's what we have to find out. So to find the resistance at 100 degree Celsius, what we will do is we have used this formula RT equals to R naught 1 plus alpha T, where R naught naught means the initial temperature or the temperature at 0 degree, so which is 10 ohm. Alright, then alpha is this value, the coefficient, temperature coefficient of resistance. Okay, this value is given, this one. Okay, so this is the value of alpha. So alpha is this much per degree Celsius. Small t is the difference in temperature. Remember that it is the difference in temperature. So here difference in temperature means 100 minus 0, because initial temperature is 0 and final temperature is the boiling point of water. So boiling point of water is 100. So 100 minus 0, if you do, it becomes 100 degree Celsius only. Alright, then RT you have to find out. So you substitute all the values in this equation, you'll get the value of RT, which is the resistance at temperature 100 degree Celsius. Suppose, just an example, instead of this 0 degree, if it is written like 30 degree Celsius, suppose 30 degree, then in that case the value of T will be how much? 100 minus 30, so it will be 70 degree then. Alright, so this thing you have to remember. Okay, then one more thing regarding this question only. Suppose here the value of alpha is given in degree in per degree Celsius. That is why the temperature we are taking in degree Celsius. Okay, if it is in per Kelvin, suppose if the value of alpha is given 0.004 per Kelvin, then the temperature should also be in Kelvin scale, right? But the basically, if you take the difference in Kelvin and degree Celsius scale, the difference generally comes same only. Anyways, this thing you remember. Then question number 3. So it is given that a circuit using a potentiometer and a battery of negligible internal resistance is set up as shown to develop a constant potential gradient along the wire. 2 cells, okay. Of EMF E1 and E2 are connected in series as shown in the figure. So what you have to do is 1 and 2, the balancing points are obtained respectively at 400 and 240 centimeter from A. Find E1 by E2. Alright. So here in this question you can see that this is the arrangement of a potentiometer. Now if you remember when we discussed about potentiometer, I made a diagram. It was like this one, like this, then it was a metal strip, then the wire goes like this, metal strip, it goes like this, then it comes like this. This is point A, point B, then there we connect the other circuits, right? That was the diagram. But here it is a simplified potentiometer, and in this simplified potentiometer this is the actual wire, right? So here this wire is nothing but this one only, A to this point. I can give any name like B. So this AB length of the wire is this part only, AB. Here it was A, here it was B. If you stretch it, it becomes a long wire, and that wire is this one only, AB. Alright? Okay. Now let us see what is there in the circuit. So if you remember when we discussed about how to find out, how to compare the EMF of two cells, then we used a two-way key. This is the two-way key, okay, and in this with this two-way key, what we can do, once we can connect, this is one pair of primary cell, this is another pair of primary cell, okay. So once we can connect these two cell in the main circuit at a time, and then again we can connect these two cell at the with the main circuit at the next case, okay. So when we compare the EMF of two cells, in that case, if you remember, we started with this formula, E1 is equal to K into L1. L1 is the balancing length, okay. So here in the first case, how much is the balancing length? Here you can see that 1 and 2 is written, no? This is 1. 1 means when 1 is there in the circuit, means this two cells are connected in the circuit, okay, and 2 means this, 2 means what, this one, 2, 2 means the down, this 2 cells which is at the in the down, no, this 2, so this 2 cells when connected in the circuit, okay, so 1 and 2 represents that. Anyways, now let us see, as I told you that when we discuss potentiometer, the first thing that we wrote is KL1 or E1 is equal to KL1, right? This equation we wrote. But here, once you are connecting this point and this point, E1 plus E2 is coming in the circuit together. So what is the total EMF then? E1 plus E2. So instead of writing E1 is equal to KL1, what we are supposed to write? We are supposed to write E1 plus E2 is equal to KL1. Okay, that is the first equation, this one, equation number 1, this line. Second case, in second case now we will connect 2 with the two-way key. 2 means which 2 cells we are connecting. 2 means this part. This part we are connecting with the main circuit. Okay, so in this case there is a twist. You can see E2 is just connected as the previous connection, positive towards left, negative towards right, but E1 is connected in opposite way, positive towards right, negative towards left. So what is the total EMF of this part? Sorry, this part means that 2, this part only. Total EMF of this part, how much is that? E2 is, as usual, it is connected, so it is positive. E1 is connected opposite, so it will be negative. So total EMF is E2 minus E1. And this thing already I told you when we discussed about series combination of two cells. I told you that if their polarity is same, we will add them. But if their polarity is different, opposite, we will subtract it. So E2 minus E1. So for the next case, in this branch, how much potential we have? E2 minus E1. And for that, the balancing length is how much? 240. So the next equation becomes E2 minus E1 is equal to KL2. Alright? So, that's what I have written in equation number 2. Next is just rest is calculation only. What you have to find out is E1 by E2. So for that, we will just divide equation 1 by 2. 1 by 2. If you divide, we'll get this. Then you do cross multiplication. And once you do cross multiplication, easily you will get the ratio E1 by E2, which is 1 by 4 in this case. Okay. Simple one. Then the last one, number 4. So here this is nothing but it is the application of Kirchhoff's law. This type of sum already I told you, we discussed once. I gave you one example also. So let us see this sum also. Use Kirchhoff's rules to determine the values of current I1, I2, I3. Sometimes maybe I1, I2, I3 may not be mentioned. It may be like this also. Find the current in each branch of the circuit. Each branch of the circuit means it is I1, I2, I2 and I3 only, okay, as shown in the figure. Now see, in the figure, the direction the direction of I1, I2, I3 is mentioned, but there may be figure where the directions of I1, I2, I3 or the amount of current, nothing is mentioned, only these things are there. Suppose the resistance is there and the EMF of the cells are mentioned, then what will you do? So in that case, you have to consider the direction of current by yourself only. That means you can do it like this. Suppose from this cell some current is coming out. Suppose this is I3. So this current, once it goes and it reaches point F, it will be splitted up into two parts. One will go towards this side, which is I1 in this case. One will go down, which is I2. So in simple word, I3 is getting splitted up into two parts, I1 and I2. So we can write this one, I3 equals to I1 plus I2 from KCL, Kirchhoff's first law. This was Kirchhoff's first law, that the current entering at a point is equal to the current leaving the point. So if you notice point F, in point F, how much current is entering? I3. And how much current is leaving? I1 and I2. So I3 goes to I1 plus I2. Okay, then in this way you can give the direction like this. I1 goes like this, it will go this way, and then finally it will come in the battery. It will move like this. I2, it goes this way, and this way. Okay, so these are the direction of current in the branch of the circuit according to the figure. Or in fact, if in the figure if it is not mentioned, you can consider the direction in this way. In fact, you can consider the direction in other way also. Other way means, suppose if you consider from 80 volt, suppose I1 current is coming out. This current when reaches to point C, it will get split up. Suppose one part is going through this way, another is going through this way. Through this way, the current going is I2, suppose. Total was I1, I2 is going this way, then this side how much current will remain? I1 minus I2. In this way also you can do. Means what I said, I1 is the total current, right? It is coming out like this. At point C, it will split up. I2 is going through this side. I2. So how much is the remaining current? I1 minus I2, which will go through this way. This way. I1 minus I2. Okay, in that way also you can consider, not a problem. But since in the question it is given, so we will go accordingly. So next thing is, we have to consider loops. As we know, Kirchhoff's second law we have to apply. So here, first of all, which loop we will consider? A, B, C, F, A. A, B, C, F, A. So in this loop you can see that according to the name, you know the rule, right? That according to the name, we are moving like this, A, B, C, F, A, and the direction of current is also same only. From F to A to B, B to C, C to F, right? Same direction. So the name, according to the naming of the loop, the direction of current is also same way. So that means this side, what we are supposed to write, I into R. I into R means I1 into 30 once, I1 into 30 plus, it will be plus because it is in the same direction. The naming of the loop and the direction of current is same. So here we have one plus. So plus, how much is that? Next, where we have resistance in the loop, this one, how much is that? 20. And how much is the current through 20? I3. So here we will write IR, no? That means I3 into 20. Then equal sign. Then in right hand side, we are supposed to write the EMF of the cell present in the loop. So in this loop, we have only one cell which is of 20 volt. And if you see, we have named the loop like A, B, C, D, C, F, A. So if you go this way, the direction, we know that from, since this is a battery, this is the positive side, this is the negative side, right? So from positive only current is supposed to come out like this. So if that means the direction of current present in the loop and the naming of the loop is in the same direction. Or in other words, you can think it like this. This is the conventional direction of current, isn't it? This is the negative, this is the positive. So from positive only current comes out. So the direction of current should be like this. And the naming of the loop is also in the same way. So the sign of this 20 will be positive. Suppose in this case, if the battery is like this, this side is positive, this side is negative, then what will happen? Negative. Negative, okay. Then what will happen? If we name the loop like A, B, C, F, A, in that case, the according to name, we are going like this. But since this is the positive, the direction of current should be like this. So, according to the naming of the rule, naming of the loop, and the direction of actual current which comes out of the battery are not same. Current is coming out from the positive side, it is going this way, but the naming of the loop we have done like this, like this we have done. Okay, so in that case it will be negative. Okay, in the next case it will be clear. So anyways, here we will put equation number 1 after simplifying. Simplifying means from this equation, if you divide it by 10, we get this equation. And after that, what we did is, okay, here equation 1 no need. Okay, better we do it like this. In place of I3, we have substituted this value, I1 plus I2. So I3 is replaced by I1 plus I2. So if you simplify, we will get this equation. Okay, this is given equation number 1. Now we will take the next loop. Next loop means F, C, D, E, F. Okay, one more thing. If we go like this, F, C, D, E, F, and if you see the current in the circuit, it is just opposite. Right? We are going like this, F, C, D, E, F. We are moving in clockwise direction. Okay? Is it clockwise? Yeah, it is clockwise only. But the direction of current in the circuit is anti-clockwise. So, we will get negative values. Okay? And one more thing, negative values means how much it will be? 20 into I3 minus 20 I3. 20 into I2, so minus 20 I3 minus 20 I2. And what will be this? Here, see, in the loop we have two battery, and if you see both the battery, the naming we have gave like this, no, FC. So F2C we are moving, but if you see the positive of the battery, it is this side. So current from the battery, current is supposed to come like this, in this direction, but we are moving from F to C. So what is the polarity of this? Minus 20. Similarly, we are naming like this, F, C, D, E, D, E. So from D to E we are moving, but since this is the positive, current is coming like this, opposite. So for that, AT will also be minus. So in right hand side, what we will get? Minus 20, minus 80. Okay, so let us see this equation we are supposed to get. Alright, this one. So now all the negative sign we can cancel out. So what we'll have? 20 I2, 20 I3, and this is plus 100. So if you divide it by 20, we get this value, which is equation number 2. So we got equation 1 and equation 2. And next what we can do is this one. Okay, equation 2 we have modified little bit. In place of I3, we substituted I1 plus I2. We can do that. Why we are doing so? So that equation 1, we get two such equation having same kind of variable. So in place of I3, we have given I1 plus I2. If you simplify, we will get this. Okay, I1. So this value of I1, it is substituted in equation 1 by substitution method. You can solve it in elimination method also, not a problem. But I have done here by substitution method, and if you calculate, this is just simplification. Okay, you just go through, you just see this one, you'll understand. Simplification is done, and from this we got the value of I2 is this much ampere. Once you get I2, you can substitute the value of I2 in this equation to get I1, like this. Okay, and I1 is obtained minus, you can get negative value, not an issue. Then once you get I1 and I2, what you have to find out is I3. So I3 is what? I1 plus I2 from KCL. Okay, so I1 plus I2, if you do, you get this value. So in this way, we can find out the current flowing in each branch of the circuit. So we have completed this chapter, as well as we discussed some sums. So in next class, we will start semiconductor. So for today, thank you.